So what I'm going to do now is show you some beautiful mathematics. We can't do much in physics, or we can't start this discussion properly as far as Lagrangians and Hamiltonians are concerned if we don't understand the concept of the minimum. Something is at a minimum, and that is how nature decides what to do. Nature decides that the shortest distance between two points in Euclidean space is going to be a straight line. How does it decide that? There is, must be something underlying this decision in nature. It's the concept of the minimum. And you've got to understand it through the concept of the calculus of variations. So how do we do that? It's going to be many boards, and I'll have to wipe the board in between. Let's just have a look at this. I have the xy plane, and I have two points, which is a starting point and a final point, and there's various paths I can take through this. So Euclidean space, there's my x, and there's my y. I'm going to go from one point to the other point on some path. We can imagine I can go to Andromeda Galaxy and back, and that will still be one path. If Andromeda is there, at least if I can just go in a two-dimensional plane. There is many lines I can take between this. But I want the shortest possible distance between those two. The shortest possible distance. Now, one way I can measure this, any of the paths that I can possibly choose, is just to divide it into tiny little segments of, say, a specific length, delta s. So let's blow that up a little bit. If I were to blow that up, it's almost going to be a straight line. You can, most lecturers would skip this bit and go straight just to the integral, but let's just do it. So this is going to be this arc length. It has a length, but it will have from that point to that point a delta y and a delta x. So the length of delta s is very nearly going to be what? Well, the square root of that plus that. This is Pythagorean theorem. So that will be delta x squared plus delta y squared. Very beautiful. And we know if I can let delta x approach, what's take the limit as this approaches zero, this is going to become smaller, this line segment will become shorter, and right in the end, I'm going to have this differential tiny little distance ds, which is going to be the square root of dx squared plus dy squared. We can all see that. And I can rewrite this. Just want to show you how nice you can rewrite it. Of course, you're going to say ds is going to equal the square root of, I can take a dx squared out, which will leave me 1 plus dy squared over dx squared. It's beautiful. I've just taken this out as a common factor. If I were to multiply this back in there, of course, I'm going to land back up there. In other words, ds I can write as the square root of 1 plus, let's just call it y prime, y with respect to x squared. Now that's very ugly, I should do that. That you can see is the whole, it's dy squared and dx squared. Okay, so that, and I'm just calling it y prime dx. That's what I'm doing. So that will be the length of an infinitesimally small little line segment there. I've zoomed in so much that it actually is a straight line, so I go from approximate to absolutely equal to, and that is in the limit as delta x goes to zero. And what can I do? How do we do integration? If I have to just sum all of these together, I take the integral of that. So if I were to take the integral of both sides, what am I left with? S, the total distance of this arc, so this is just a line integral, is going to be this definite integral and going from x sub 1 to x sub 2 of the square root of 1 plus y prime square dx. So there's my line integral. Okay. And this is setting up distance But this needn't be distance. I can set up many things in physics. I might want to know what the shortest time is. So there's going to be some path chosen that represents the shortest time. I can have many things in here. I can have not just distance, but shape, what would be the minimum surface area of something. And I can do that by just setting up an equation for surface area. Okay, so in what we do in calculation of calculus of variations is we're just going to call this I, that is just a group for not only length, but surface area, time, anything is going to be something that I can now plot on a, so this needn't be distance and distance, we can have something else, but it's going to go from some initial point which I'll call x sub 1 and some final point which I'll call x sub 2, okay, just to refer to the fact that it is something on one of the axes, okay, of some function, and if I look at this function very carefully, it's actually a function of x, y, and y prime with respect to that axis. So it's from one point to other point on that axis. So it's the f of x, y, and y prime. Now there's no x in there, but that one might as well have been x to the power 0, so there is, and there's y, there's no y, just a normal y in there, but that might also have just been y to the power 0. In effect, this is a distance one, so there was no x and y in there, but there could be. So there's a function of x, y, and y prime. So at any time, we can set this up, and it's called a functional. This is called a functional that I'm going to do something, and it's going to give me some scalar value. And I'll clean the board, and we're going to use this concept to prove to you that in Euclidean space, in other words, not some funny space, this flat space, that the shortest distance between that point and that point is going to be a straight line. We're going to develop this to prove that that is indeed so. And through doing that, hopefully I'll show you that that is what nature does and that's what we can do. We're going to use the calculus of variation to show that there is something in here that is a minimum distance and or a minimum time or a minimum surface area. And that is what nature chooses. I'm going to clean the board and we'll carry on. The board is clean, let's have a look. So there we go. Now imagine, I'm going to construct something. So imagine I knew the answer. The equation for that curve between the two points, which is the minimum. Imagine I knew that and that solution was the y of x. Small y, sorry, of x. Now let's construct another function, we'll call it capital Y of x, and that's going to include this small y of x plus some constant multiple of a second function called eta of x. That's most textbooks will do it this way. And I'm going to pause the video here and just insert another video I made, which is a screencast of now this is actually the absolute truth. Before I do that, I just want to make two things abundantly clear. And we're going to set this up. This is like a magician setting up something specifically so that it works out for him or her. And we're going to set this situation up so that it does work for us. So there's, for instance, my one point and my other point. And we all know intuitively this is going to end up being a straight line. But what if it isn't? So I have this curve there. And right at this x sub 1, and right at this x sub 2, I'm going to choose another curve, and that's my curve, eta of x, such that at these points, x1 and x2, it has a y value of 0. And I can choose many of these just by changing this constant multiple eta. If eta is 1, this would be one curve. If eta is 1.5, it will be another curve. If eta is -3, this will be another curve. And this was my true answer, which is a secret up till now, but imagine I knew what it was. And if I just add this, so at every point I just add these two, then I was going to have something like this. But you can imagine this capital Y of X, this capital Y of X is just these two added to each other, but you imagine they are multiple. For every eta of x, I can choose any constant which will give me an infinite number of these little curves, which means added to the real answer, I can get many others. And remember, single variable, just normal variable calculus, if I just had a curve, if I had a curve and I wanted to know the minimum of the maximum, well, all these extreme points, extrema, would be at spots where the derivative, the first derivative, was going to be zero. That is a minimum or a maximum, and I knew it was a minimum if I took the second derivative, and if that answer was, at that point, was larger than zero, I knew that to be a minimum. And that's the same thing we're going to do to this. We want a minimum. We're going to take the derivative of this and set it equal to zero. Remember, this is how I set up my distance. I had s equals the definite integral going from x1 to x sub 2 of the square root of 1 plus y prime squared dx. That was my distance. I want to take the derivative of that and I want to set it equal to zero. And if I do that, I'm going to get to the minimum point. And that's what we want. I want to construct something that this line falls exactly on top of that line, because if I do that, it'll be some minimum, and that will be the true result that I get there. I'm ahead of myself. So this is what we set up. I'm going to pause the video here and insert that little bit just to show you that this is an actual fact. You can set this up many ways. You can set this up, and this is not some trickery here that is mathematically unsound. It's very sound. You can set this up, and I'll show you in the video. So here we go. Let me show you. I want to construct this capital Y of X in terms of small y of x plus some other function, eta of x, and that eta of x I want to be able to multiply by some constant. So I've set some things up here. Let's have a look at them. Let's just take some of these away, and let's just bring them back one by one. So imagine just that this is my y of x. I've made it a straight line. It needn't be a straight line. And here's my eta of x. And I'm just drawing in these two straight lines, just to note that I've constructed eta x. In this instance, it is something here. There we go. There's my epsilon, which I've called n here. And it's just minus x minus 4 squared plus 1. That's this little curve here, and I'll show you now why I put the n in there. So what I'm saying is one thing. I've got to construct this so that at x1 and x2, which is this spot here and that spot there, I want that to correspond here to the same values. That's why I've got the two straight lines, and the fact that the y value for eta of x down here has got to be 0 and 0 at both points. That's the way I want to set this up. So what I have now is the capital Y of X, and the capital Y of X between X1 and X2 has got to be the addition of these two. And this is what we have right up here. This is this green. Note though, that because eta of X is 0, at this point I'm not adding anything to small Y of X, and at that point I'm not adding anything to small Y of X. But there is the addition of these two curves. At every point on the x-axis between x1 and x2, if I added this value to that value, I was going to get that top value. That's what I'm saying. But look at this. If I put eta in front of it, which here I've called n, it doesn't matter what size I make eta. It's just some constant multiple, epsilon, I mean. My small little, my n here is epsilon. Sorry for that. It doesn't matter what value I make epsilon. It's a constant multiple. It is a constant multiple of eta of x. And these points still correspond to my little y of x and my little y of x there. So it doesn't matter. I now have this almost, well, I can say indefinite number of capital Y of x. Every time that I change epsilon, I'm going to have a different capital Y of x. Look at the green curve. There are so many of them. Look how many of them there are. That means to get from one point, point one, to point two, there are many, many paths that I can take. And I've got to find the shortest one, basically. That's why I'm setting up this problem. I want some minimum value. And the problem that we are going to deal with, obviously, minimum arc length between these two points. but just to show you that I can construct this capital Y of X in the manner that I've done on the board. And it makes absolute sense, and you can just see it beautifully in this illustration. Good, I hope you enjoyed that. Now this is beautiful mathematics. Stay with me, you'll see where this is going. So what we're suggesting here, remember that was my equation, and I'm going to take the derivative of that and set it equal to zero. That will give me the minimum value. That's all we're going to do. But I don't have this anymore. I've changed it. That refers to what I had in there. The real answer was going to come from that. Was going to come from that. The distance. The real distance was going to have some equation to it. Some value to it. But now I have this. So what I, in actual fact, have now is a new function in X, capital Y and capital Y prime. That is what I have now. So by constructing this addition, I've changed it from X small y prime to X large y prime. So some suggestion of this would be, remember that was the square root of 1 plus y squared, y prime squared, the square root of 1 plus y prime squared. But if I do this to it, I'm going to have this as my f of x. I have this, and I'm going to just do some preliminary work, and you'll see shortly why I'm doing this preliminary work. If I had this function, imagine, let me just write it out, the y of x equals the y of x plus epsilon eta of x. What if I were to take the derivative of this with respect to this constant? Can you take a derivative with respect to a constant? Of course you can, because what is 4 other than 4x to the power 0? Okay, if I were to take the derivative with respect to x, I can still take the derivative here with respect to x. That's probably not the best way to explain it. Let me rather do this. Can I say dy, capital Y of x, d epsilon? Can I say that? Now, I don't necessarily want to do that. It's going to be a bit difficult. Let's do the partial derivative of the partial derivative with respect to that constant. Well, it doesn't appear there, so that's going to equal zero. And I could have written this with an x to the power zero. And what you can see this as basically, I suppose, is just the product of two functions. So I can take the derivative of this times that, and this times the derivative of that. So I can actually have di epsilon eta x plus eta times d del, whatever, whichever way you want to pronounce it, of eta x. So what are we going to have here? We're going to have the fact that's zero. That is 1, so we will definitely have that. So that'll be the eta of x. And there's no eta in there, so the partial derivative of that with respect to epsilon, sorry, is 0, 0 times epsilon is 0. So the derivative of capital Y of x with respect to epsilon is just eta of x. Let's take y prime of x. Well, that's just going to be that, prime. And you can put examples in here and just show it to yourself. And what is going to happen here? Well, it's with respect to x that I'm taking this derivative. That is a function of x. So this is very easy. This is just going to be epsilon eta prime of x. And what were to happen if I took the partial derivative of y prime with respect to epsilon? Okay, there's definitely a partial derivative, there's nothing in there, that's going to be a zero. And exactly the same thing as happened there is going to happen here, so we're just going to have eta prime of x. So that's all we're going to have. So these are the two equations, some preliminary work. I probably shouldn't have brought it in here because you wonder, why is he doing this? Why is he doing this? Let's clean the board and we'll carry on. Now remember, just think back I had my equation, which was this 1 plus y prime squared, square root of that. What were to happen if I took the derivative of this function? Well, I would have had to use the chain rule. So when I had the f of x, y, and y prime, I was going to have to use the chain rule. Nothing changes if I have this, if I have that function, I'm also going to have the chain rule. But because I have changed this into that, I have a new function I, which I now want to make a function of epsilon. That is now going to be x sub 1 to x sub 2 of the f of x, capital Y prime dx. Okay, I have now changed, when I went from my previous solution to this solution, I have now made this a function of eta, because I could get many y of x's by simply just changing this constant. So this now becomes a constant of this function. And if I wanted to take the derivative of this, if I wanted to take the derivative of this with respect to epsilon, why did I say eta all the time? You know what I mean when I write these things. When I write this with respect to, take this derivative with respect to epsilon, what is going to happen? Now, that is why I chose things very carefully. I also want to do it at a point where epsilon equals zero. And that's why I set things up so. Remember what I showed you on the screencast? That's why I chose things. One of the reasons, and there's another reason you'll see it's coming up. I wanted to, because if that equals zero, then my large y of x, this one, will be exactly equal to this one. They'll fall on top of each other, and I'll have my solution. Okay. And another thing is, remember when I took the derivative? When f at is zero, I have a minimum. So this is the secret to this whole thing. I'm going to take the derivative. So I've changed it to a function of eta. I'm going to take the derivative with respect to eta, exactly where eta is zero. And if I set it equal to zero, I know I have a minimum. That is the calculation, the calculus of variations. Now, just as we had here, I would have had to use the chain rule. Let's use the chain rule of this, because if I take the derivative of this, it's actually this. If I take the derivative of I with respect to eta, it's the same as doing my integral and taking the derivative of this inside. Remember your first year calculus. So what we're saying here, that is going to equal the definite integral going from this to that, and I'll have to apply the chain rule. So I'm actually going to have di f di capital Y times del Y del epsilon plus, you must not make a mistake here, and I'm going to have f with respect to y prime times y prime over epsilon, all of that dx. So don't get confused there. This is just the chain rule of a function, of any function. Remember, if you were to take the chain rule of something, if you were to take the first derivative of something as simple as this, it would be very easy to do. This was going to be to the power half, you bring the half forward, and that becomes negative a half, and then you do the derivative of the inside function as well, which is just going to be 2y prime. So it's easy to do. So for that, for any function f of x, y, and y prime, I was going to use the chain rule. So here I'm also going to use the chain rule, nothing different, and that's exactly what I have there. And remember, just the board before, I did this, and I did this, so I know what this is. This was, remember what this was? Oh, that was this eta of x. Remember that? Rewind and you'll see, and what was this? It was eta prime of x. Okay, so that works for me. And this has got to equal zero. Because if I set it equal to zero, then I have a minimum. Okay, we know we have, well, it's going to be a minimum, it's going to be an extremum. But let's call it a minimum for now, because that is exactly what it is. Okay, so we are there. What I want you to realize is one thing. I can do this as integration by parts. Remember the integration by parts? I just have to decide which one is u and which one is v prime. And that's very easy to do. Let's choose my v prime equal to this, eta prime of x. That makes my v equal eta prime, eta of x. And if this was that, then that must mean this one is u, die f, die capital Y prime, and that makes my u prime the d dx of die f, die Y prime. Now I can just simply do integration by parts. Remember that will be this times that, minus the integral of this one times that one. Remember, integration by parts. But I want to show you something very specific here as well, and that's why I set things up. I was a magician and I set things up that they work out specifically for me. I said I want to do this around a point where eta equals zero. And what's going to happen when eta equals zero? When eta equals zero, capital Y of x and small y of x are going to be exactly the same thing. They're going to be exactly the same thing. So what we're going to have is the following. So remember when I have the integral of the sum of two functions, I can just do them separately. So here I'm going to have x sub 1 to x sub 2 of del f del y. I'm making it a small y now because I'm setting things up when epsilon equals 0. So then I will have capital and lowercase y of x as being exactly the same, times the eta of x dx plus, now for this side I'm going to do this integration by parts, so it's u times v, so it's these two, so it's die f die y prime times eta of x at from x sub 1 to x sub 2 minus the integral of going from x sub 1 to x sub 2 of these two, so it's d dx of del f del y prime eta, oi, what was that? Eta of x dx, and that's going to equal 0. I hope you can still see that. Now, remember also what I did here? I let these two points be exactly the same. So if I were to plug those into there, I was going to get 0. So this whole term disappears. This whole term disappears. And what am I left with? This integral minus this integral is going to equal 0. I can put them all together in the same integral because this is the difference between two functions. And I can take these two out as a common factor. And what am I going to be left with? Going from x sub 1 to x sub 2 of what? Well, we're going to have del f del y minus the d dx of del f del y prime, all of that times the eta of x, all of that dx is going to equal 0. And that, lo and behold, is where we were trying to get. This is a thing of beauty. Now, I want to set this up for any eta of x. Any eta of x. Because for a definite integral to equal 0, that means this inner part, this integrand, has got to be 0. But I want it to be for any function of 0, so any arbitrary function of eta. And so if that can't be 0, it's being multiplied by this, this has got to equal 0. And that is the Euler Lagrange function, and it states the following: that die f die y of del f del y minus the d dx of del f del y prime equals 0. There we are. That is the thing of beauty. And remember when my f was this? This was my f of x, y, and y prime. If I were to take the derivative of this with respect to y, and I took the derivative of this with respect to y prime, and then the derivative of that, and set it equal to 0, I was going to get the answer for the shortest distance between those two points. but I generalized it as I, so it might be the shortest time, it might be the shortest surface area. I can use the Euler Lagrange equation to set up many physical problems. If I can just, through my physical problem, develop this, and we'll look at examples in the next video, I might just show you, prove to you then that the shortest distance between two points is a straight line by solving this Euler Lagrange. But this Euler Lagrange equation right here is absolutely a thing of beauty. And we set it up right from here, right from the start. We use the simple fact that the first derivative, if you set it to zero, you are going to get an extreme point. And that extreme point is going to be a minimum value for you. It's always going to, it's going to work out in this instance to be a minimum. Let's call it a minimum instead of an extreme point. And you're going to land up with this. This is really, truly a thing of mathematical beauty. Now, let me prove to you that the shortest distance between two points on the Euclidean surface is just a straight line. Nature will always choose a straight line. So you'll remember my equation for using integration, a line integral for the length of any arc is that. Here's my Euler Lagrange equation. So let's just do that. There's my f, there's my function f, function of x, y, and y prime. Let's get if thy y, what is that going to equal of just this bit? Well, there's no y in there, so that's just going to be zero. That was a simple one. What is thy f thy y prime? Well, there's a y prime in there, so I better do this properly, and I've got to do it. We said it before, I've got to do it by the following method. So what is that going to be? I'm going to bring the half forward, so that was going to be a half times we were still going to have this squared to the power negative a half, and then I still have to multiply that by the inner, which is going to be 2 times y prime. That's really first year calculus, except that this is a partial derivative, but there is y primes in there. So these two are going to go. So what am I left with? I'm left with y prime over the square root of 1 plus y prime squared. That's what I'm left with. And so there I'm left with 0. So I have minus ddx of that, which is now just this, of y prime over the square root of 1 plus y prime squared is going to equal 0, which I can multiply both sides by negative 1, so this will disappear. Simply, when is the derivative of any function equal to 0? When that function is a constant, isn't it? So all of this is some constant. In other words, y prime equals some constant times the square root of 1 plus y prime squared. I can square both sides. If I square both sides, I get rid of this, and I square my constant, which just leaves me with another constant. I can multiply this constant in there, so I'm going to have c plus some constant of that. I can bring this over to one side, which means y prime. I can get on its own, which is then going to leave me with one minus this squared. Remember, I've squared this now to get rid of that. And that is going to then still equal some constant. I'm going to divide this into that side, which just gives me another constant. And in the end, I'm going to take the square root of that, so y prime is going to be some constant in the end. Just run through that. I've done it in a very ugly fashion there. But just do it for yourself. You'll notice very quickly that y prime just equals some constant. And when is the derivative? How can a function of x, y prime of x, how can that be a constant? Well, the only way that that can be is if the y of x equals ax plus b. Because if I were to take the derivative of that, that would come forward. So that's just my constant a. There's no x in there, so that falls away. And what is that an equation of? A straight line. Proof that the shortest distance between any two points in the Euclidean, two-dimensional Euclidean plane is a straight line. How did I solve that? I set up my differential here my equation here, which is my my differential there, and I used the calculation of the calculus of variations to set up the Lagrange Euler equation. I used the Lagrange Euler equation, and I proved that the shortest distance is there. So if I set something else up here, any physical system, I'll have to set up this function f. And if I can set that function of f with its time, with its surface area, I can use the Lagrange Euler equation, and that will always, always give me the minimum. That is why I can set up a physical system where I can look at time, what would be the shortest time. I can set up the surface area, and the most famous one of those is if you have two rings, one smaller, one larger, and you put them in some of this bubbly, soapy water, and you bring them out and you'll separate them, and that will form a very specific pattern between those two soapy bubble circles. Okay, and nature chooses that, and there's a reason nature chooses that, because that will give you the minimum surface area, that whole surface area of the soapy fluid material between these two. You've got to make that a minimum, and the minimum, and you can do it for volume as well. Why is the smaller volume a sphere? And nature does that because it is a minimum, and some minimum is chosen. And lastly, from that will come this fact: if you have a ball that has to roll down a plane, that has to roll down, what is going to be the shortest time for that ball to roll down? Is it going to be a path that goes straight down in time, or is it going to be one of these paths? That is called the brachistochrone problem, brachy, which means short, chrome, referring to time, shortest time. There's a reason why this ball will roll down, will get from there to there faster than the ball rolling down that path. There's a reason for that, because nature can choose the minimum time. That's what nature does. It wants to choose the minimum time to get from there to there, and that is why it will choose a specific path that will be the shortest path to get down there. You just have to work out an f of x for this problem.